those of you who've made it here on a Saturday evening, thank you very much to take a seat. I know that there'll be people probably stuck in the traffic given we have our Prime Minister visiting to inaugurate something in the city, but we're hoping that those of you who are art lovers, and some of them, will join us as the evening proceeds. My name is Vidita Vaidya. I'm a neurobiologist at the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, and I'm a member of the TIFR Art and Archives Committee. It's my pleasure to welcome you here today on behalf of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research and also on behalf of the Art and Archives Committee. I'm going to take a few minutes to tell you what this committee does and why we believe it's going to be the bridge between TIFR as a scientific institution and the city of Mumbai. So TIFR is an old scientific institution, young by most international terms in terms of institutional history, but old in terms of the fact that it actually parallels the history of modern India. The idea of the Indian future that was imagined at the time of independence in many ways can also be seen in the details of how TIFR came to be. Our founding director, Homi Bhabha, besides being a physicist, was also someone who was deeply interested in the arts. And that started a project of collecting an incredible collection that we now, who are today TIFR faculty members, are the custodians of. To be custodians of this sort of a legacy is a huge responsibility, and while we might take it for granted that we see these paintings every single day, it's actually our responsibility to share it with the city of Mumbai that houses this institution. We've been discussing this as an Art and Archives Committee. How do we open our doors? How do we start sharing the collection that we have with the Mumbai community, in particular the arts community in the city? We believe that if we do so, we will reinvent and reimagine our own science eventually, because we'll open the doors to new people coming in and talking to us. I'm going to actually hand over to Sridhar. Sridhar is a particle physicist. He's the one from our committee who has spearheaded the effort along with Mini Menon. And it's a pleasure when along the way you actually make a new friend. So Mini and Akshay from Life History India, we wouldn't have done this without you guys just coming along and pushing us to think about ways in which we could really preserve and start opening up this legacy. This would never have started without Maud Chatterjee. That's how the original ideas of opening up and curating TIFR's art collection came. The previous Art and Archives committees that have come before us and the ones that will come in the future after us, we hold a responsibility to something that was started off by Bhabha many, many decades ago. But hopefully at least we open this idea of sharing not just our art collection, but also our archives. It's a journey of how an institution is built in modern India, and it is something which is well worth sharing. So I'll hand over to Sridhar, and he's going to be your MC for this evening, and he's the one who's really spearheaded it, so it's all over to Sridhar.
Thanks, Vidhi. Those of you who know me, of course, know I like to keep things very informal, but this is even too informal for me, so apologies. Okay. I thought of several things to say. I'm a little addled now, so I don't even know whether I'll recollect it the way I actually planned it. But a couple of things I wanted to start off by saying. I wanted to share my thoughts about what I think is the TIFR art collection and why it is special. Okay. The TIFR art collection is unique in a way, not quite like other institutional collections. Mott is in fact an expert on institutional collections, but I want to say that the fact that it is housed in a science institute where science research is going on makes it very special. It's not simply a site for the art collection, but it actually represents and holds the potential for becoming a confluence of two cultures, of art and science, okay? And that, I think, is a very, very important way to look at this collection. In fact, if you look at collections around the world which are housed in universities, even those collections generally tend to be interacting with and looked after by the arts and the humanities communities of those universities. The connection with the science is often very, very minimal. Even in very big places like CERN in Geneva, for example, the arts effort is a very, very fledgling effort. I think we are far, far ahead of them in what we have done with our art. Okay. So I think it is with this realization that we have to go into understanding what the TIFR art collection is about. The fact that we have such a wonderful collection, and as Vidita correctly pointed out, is thanks to our founding director, Homi Bhabha. But I would actually go further to say that it was, I see four people as being the figureheads, if you like. I mean, not that they didn't do anything, but they were figureheads in the sense that they represented four different stakeholders in building up this institution and in particular building up this art collection. And these four people I would like to think of as Homi Bhabha, Homi J. Bhabha, that is, Homi Bhabha and Jawaharlal Nehru, first Prime Minister, and J.R.D. Tata, if I may, and M.F. Hussain. Okay. So I'm really talking about the institution, the state, the private enterprise, and the art world. Okay. So each of them represent one of these. And when we often say Homi Bhabha, we don't really mean only Bhabha was responsible for this collection. In fact, as people like Nalini Malani would testify, after Bhabha, M.J.K. Menon took forward the work of, you know, building up and sustaining this collection. There were others also involved in this, like K. Chandrasekharan was a mathematician at that time, who was actually on the art committee and responsible for the decisions on buying several works of art. But when I talk about these four individuals, I really mean these four systems. Okay. The 60s or the 50s were halcyon days, and the equation that was set up between these four stakeholders were very, very beneficial to the science system at that time. That equation has changed. Post-emergency has changed a lot. And while I wouldn't say that science funding reduced, but funding for something like art in a science institution certainly reduced, or just vanished, in fact. And the typical reaction of the science community has been that, okay, let's just, you know, retreat back into our holes, let's go back to our ivory towers, and let's do our research, what we are good at doing, why get involved with things which we should not be involved in the first place, and why worry about it when we are not getting money for it. That is one reaction to it. But I feel that enough time has passed, and in fact, in this post-globalized era, this equation between these four stakeholders has changed even more dramatically. And this is a point I think we really need to rethink that equation. And in fact, we need to do a gestalt on how we view the interaction between the world of science and world of art. I think there is no better place to do it than TIFR, because this already has potential for that kind of coming together. And what I'm often asked by my friends in the art community is, why has TIFR stopped buying art, and when are we going to see? And when I talk of new initiatives that TIFR may be doing in the world of art, I'm always asked, when are you going to start buying again? Okay. What I think is, as I said, in this post-global world, we don't have the luxury anymore of being the kind of patron that Bhabha was. Okay. That was a very, very special moment in the history of Indian science and Indian public life. And that is not something that is going to return. What we need to do is re-envision the equation between the art and science worlds. And I think it has to be thought less in terms of patron and artist and more in terms of collaborations. And I think when there is a genuine space for collaboration that is created, we are going to actually achieve a lot in terms of both making funds available for it, because I think once the work is there, the funds will come somehow. And when I mention funds, our director also arrives, so that's a very good omen. And I think that this collaborative phase is probably what we should be seeing, this interaction between the world of science and the world of art from. Okay, I think I've said enough. I'll, as people who are doing these kind of jobs always like to say, I don't want to stand between you and the rest of the evening. What I would like to do, however, is to invite Professor Sandeep Trivedi, director of TIFR, Mini Menon, also director, but of the film, and a very, very good friend, Maud Chatterjee, gallerist, and gallerist of Chatterjee and Lal. Would you please come to the stage? We can kind of do the formal launch of the film before we actually screen it. Thank you. I'll start by asking Sandeep to say a few words.
Okay. Oh, well, I'm somehow, anyway, conditioned. Well, a very good afternoon to you all. I must apologize for being late today. But let me begin by welcoming all of you here to this evening's wonderful function. It's a very important one, actually, for us, and we've been looking forward to it for quite a while. I extend my invitations, welcome to especially all of you from outside the TIFR community who are here with us. We look forward to engaging with you more in the realm of art, but also more widely to share with you the excitement we feel and the excitement we generate in science, which we hope can connect with all things beautiful, including art. So I hope this is the first, if it is the first, of many visits. If it's not the first, I still hope you'll come back again and again. I especially invite the director, Minu, here in our midst. It's been really great to, Minu, interact with you. And I've actually, I must admit, already seen the movie because I couldn't hold back my curiosity, and it's really great. So I think we're all in for a real feast. And I also especially extend my welcome to Mortimer Chatterjee. Mortimer has been a great friend of ours. He helped curate an exhibition which was in the National Gallery of Modern Art a few years ago of the TIFR paintings. I think the first time the paintings really went out to the public at large. And we hope to continue to benefit from your involvement and guidance. I also want to thank especially the Arts and Archives Committee, Professor Vidita Vaidya, who really should be on the stage, but I guess is not, and Professor Sridhar, and the other members who've really worked so hard to bring the movie about, bring this event about, and who are going to take us forward. I think it's a very exciting new beginning. So with those words, I hand it back to Sridhar.
Mort, would you like to say something?
I need to, also say that I'm terribly excited to see the film. And the reality is that, as Professor said, one doesn't get to see the collection much outside of the Institute itself. So barring the NGMA exhibition back in 2010, the opportunities for the wider art community to have access to the paintings, I think Minnie's film in that sense is going to be terribly important, because as a document then it can go out there and it can travel and the word can get spread. So I think really as a follow-up then to the exhibition and the publication, this then becomes a really important new milestone in the history of the collection. So with that, I would just congratulate everyone involved, and I can't wait to see it, so thank you.
I'd just like to add that the film is going to go online on this internet channel called Live History India, which is Mini's channel. And I think we are going to get a lot of people watching it over various platforms. And that's the hope, at least. And I would like Mini to just share her thoughts about what this whole experience of making the film was.
Thank you so much, Sridhar, Professor, and of course, Vidhi and Mott. You know, I must confess that I came here to the TIFR for the first time as an art history student with Mott. And it is really lovely to be sitting over here, Mott, and, you know, having worked with you on this film and Sridhar and the entire team. You know, for me, it was really coming back and getting a sense of what this entire institute was all about. It's really a story which is worth not only sharing, but also a story that every Indian should imbibe, really. You know, Homi Bhabha's brilliance is something that we all know about. But he was also a man who was such a visionary, and it was an era of great visionaries between Jawaharlal Nehru and Homi Bhabha. I think they what amazed me as a history student is the sheer ambition of their vision. And I think that is lovely, and that is a point that Professor Trivedi also mentions in the film. And you know, you just have to come in and soak in the place to really feel the pulse of it. So it's been really for me a rejuvenation just to be working on this film. This is a story that must be told, especially in the times that we live in, because we have become, you know, divided. We are living in silos, art doesn't talk to science, history doesn't talk to science. And you know, I hope one day we will be able to do a lot more on the history of science with the TIFR, because that's something that I'm fascinated by. And in many senses also, I think this city needs a place where one can come in and not only breathe in the fresh air, which is a rarity, but also see the sheer beauty of this place, because we are devoid of such spaces in this in the city, in this country. And I really believe that this needs to go out to many people. And by the way, we released just a small promo on Instagram yesterday, and within about half a day, about 10,000 people had seen it. So I'm just saying that the digital medium is really about taking it to a large number of people, and I hope we can take the story of TIFR and its art collection to a really huge, huge diaspora of Indians abroad, all over the world.
Okay, so we go now to the next part of today's program, which is the panel discussion. We have two artists, Nalli Malani and Prajakta Portnis, who have very, very kindly and very much in the last moment agreed to be on this panel. And even more thankful to Meera Menezes, who, you know, literally kind of almost bulldozed her into agreeing into coming, and she took the trouble of coming all the way from Delhi to be part of this and moderate this panel and take it further. I have this very, very long bios of all these three eminent people, but I'll try to be as concise as I can about it. Meera Menezes, as I said, is an art writer and curator. She lives in Delhi. And from our point of view, she is particularly interested in that period of art, which is reflected in the TIFR collection. So she is an expert on Indian modern and contemporary art. And she also curates. And she, very interestingly, she is the author of a book on Gai Tonde called Sonata of Solitude. And in fact, that book was released right here in the Homi Bhabha Auditorium some 2 years ago. And she has, as I said, curated several exhibitions, both in India and abroad. And of course, she's also worked as a journalist for the longest time. Nalli Malani is one of India's most well-known artists. She's been practicing for the last five decades. And as I was telling Nalini, I mean, it's probably one of the few people who actually has a work in the TIFR art collection who's still around to have a conversation with. And it is remarkable that, you know, she was barely in her early 20s when she first sold her painting to the TIFR collection. And Nalini has a very, very interesting practice. But basically, her work acts as a witness to contemporary politics, and she's particularly emphasized her investigation of female subjectivity and her profound condemnation of violence. And her experimental practice encompasses theater, wall drawings, erasure performances, video shadow plays that stretch media and aesthetic boundaries. She has shown and has been feted all over the world, and I would actually mention, in fact, the recent very interesting exhibitions which I was following on social media, the shows that she had in Castello di Rivoli in Torino, and also more recently at the Centre Georges Pompidou in Paris. Her work is actually part of several major collections all over the world, in the British Museum, in the Pompidou Center, Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York, Museum of Modern Art in New York, and also the Kiran Nadar Museum in New Delhi, among many others. And in the many others, I actually forget to mention Tate Modern London. I mean, that is the kind of range Nalini has. And Prajakta Portnis is an artist who works from Bombay. And actually, bringing this panel together has personally been very satisfying for me, that I could bring together an all-woman panel today. And if one looks at the TIFR collection today, from today's perspective, one of the things one sees is that, you know, except for a few women artists like B. Prabha and Nalini Malani, and I can't remember the other names often, Nasreen, of course, then it is dominated by the male practitioners of the 50s and 60s. There has been a change in the art scene itself. Art has now many more very active women artists, and that is why we actually get to put a panel of this kind together today. Prajakta lives in Bombay, and she's working out of Bombay. Her work dwells between the intimate world of an individual and the world outside, which is separated sometimes only by a wall. She refers to the wall as a witness to history that has traces of inhabitants embedded within. The wall becomes a starting through which she addresses social and individual anxieties. Prajakta's practice sails through painting, site-specific cultural installations to public art interventions. I particularly remember a very interesting public art intervention she did in Thane, where she grew up. And maybe at some point in the discussion today, she can talk about it. Again, she has shown and displayed her work in many, many important centers across the world. And I will actually spare you the details and not go through the entire list. I have actually followed Prajakta's work quite closely, talked at length with her, and reviewed her work. And I really am very, very impressed in the kind of integrity that she displays in her work as an artist. Okay, I think I'd like to invite the panel now to the podium, and I'll ask Meera first to, contextualize this discussion. Meera will talk about period that is represented in the TIFR art collection, and then she will take over the discussion with the panel. Yes. Yes, you can. I think I would, you can come in now, if it'll be, so that Meera doesn't feel all alone there.
Good evening, everybody, and thanks for making it today. There's a lot happening in the city, we know, because we have the Mumbai Gallery Weekend, and I know a lot of people are busy there. First of all, I want to really express my deep gratitude to the TIFR for making it possible for me to be here today, and especially to Sridhar, who thought of inviting me and organizing this event. It's a pleasure for me to return to the TIFR. 3 years after I launched my book on the artist V.S. Gaitonde at this very same spot. The launch was marked by an exhibition of Gaitonde's works, which was a rare opportunity really for art lovers to see so many works at one spot by this master abstractionist. This is really one of the few collections, apart from say maybe the NGMA in Delhi, where I got to see works from Gaitonde which spanned the most important periods of his artistic trajectory. Can you hear me well? Okay. The earliest work here stems from 1958, when he was still clearly in the thrall of the Indian miniature painting tradition, and you can see clear influences of that. Then he moved to his Paul Klee-inspired period, which is represented in the collection as well, and finally to his abstract works, for which he's truly known, and the TIFR has some of the most exemplary works as well of that period. Sridhar asked me today to really contextualize, a bit of the period around the progressives, because, the film was in any case going to talk about the collection. So I'm not going to go into the collection, but this is really for people who, he said a lot of the audience would be, from the TIFR community, and therefore, while it might seem familiar to some of the people conversant with Indian art history, I'm still going to go into that a bit and sort of contextualize that period for you. Now, while it might appear surprising, but it was really the threat of World War II that gave a fillip to the Indian art scene. And the reason I say that is that Bombay, as it was known at the time, provided a safe harbor for the Jewish cultural intelligentsia, many of whom made their way to the sports city in search of refuge from Hitler's advancing armies. Among them were three Central European Jews with a deep and abiding interest in the plastic arts. These were Walter Langhammer, Rudi von Leiden, and Immanuel Schlesinger. In fact, if you go out of the auditorium and on your left-hand side, you'll see a painting by Walter Langhammer of Rudi von Leiden, and it's called The Art Critic. So, do have a look at it. Now, the trio was quickly assimilated into the upper echelons of Bombay society with its European and British expatriate population and Indian elite. Langhammer, who had been a university professor of art in Vienna, joined the Times of India as its art director. Von Leiden, the publicity officer of the Folkart brothers, a Swiss trading company, served later as the Times of India art critic. By contrast, Schlesinger entered the pharmaceutical business and set up the company Indopharma to cash in on the void left by an interruption in imports during the Second World War. Having a keen eye for art, Schlesinger was a generous benefactor who had, in buying the work of emerging artists, assembled a fine collection in Austria that he was forced to liquidate to finance his flight. Now, one of the highlights of the Bombay art scene at the time was the annual exhibition sponsored by the Bombay Art Society. It offered Indian artists the rare opportunity to show their works cheek by jowl with Europeans. V.V. Oak, a barrister and enthusiastic supporter of academic painting, headed the society, while eminent art connoisseurs like Charles Gerard of the JJ School of Art judged the annual exhibition. It was here that a young artist by the name of Maqbool Fida Hussain first drew attention when he won a prestigious award in 1947. He was soon co-opted into as one of the founder members of the Progressives Art Group, the PAG, by the rebellious artist F.N. Souza, who was itching to challenge the canons of academic and society painting prevalent at the time. Now, the word progressive in PAG was derived from the Progressive Writers Movement, an association of literary artists with communist leanings. Unlike the writers of the PWA, who had directly intervened in the socio-political debates and discussions of the time, the artists in the Progressive Arts Group were largely concerned with their own artistic practice carried out in the intimacy and confines of their studios, something that I think both Nalini, you, as well as Sudhir have alluded to, right? But outlining the raison d'etre of the PAG's formation in 1947, Souza wrote in his usual brash and macho manner, "It then occurred to me to form a group to give ourselves an incentive. Ganging up in a collective ego is stronger than a single ego. It's easier for a mob to carry out a lynching, and in this case, we found it necessary to lynch the kind of art inculcated by the JJ School of Art and exhibited in the Bombay Art Society." Now, to give you a bit of a background, many of these artists' formal initiation into the fine arts came at a momentous time, for India stood on the brink of independence, poised to throw off the yoke of British colonialism. The curriculum at the Arts College, however, largely followed the same pattern as the Royal Academy in London. But it also made concessions to Indian aesthetics by incorporating courses in Indian design, which included the study of Indian miniatures. The school had two sections, headed by different principals: the Indian style painting class, and then you had the Western section, which was headed by Charles Gerard. Now, the Western style classes revolved around anatomy, perspective, antique drawing, portrait, and still life painting in oil. And F.N. Souza, in his article in The Patriot, recalled, "Even then, I never agreed with this division between Indian and Western art. To me, knowledge was universal and aesthetics were Catholic." Little wonder then that Souza, along with several other students, was expelled from the JJ School of Art in 1945 during the Quit India movement for wanting to oust Gerard. Now, the initial core group of the PAG consisted of Souza, Sayyed Haider Raza, and Ara, whose works we saw, with Ara having made the agreement that each of them would in turn induct another member. So the group first took on Hari Ambadas Gare, then they took on Sadanand Bakre, and finally followed by Hussain. Gradually and somewhat remarkably, it assembled into a multicultural organization that cut across both social and religious lines. Hussain and Raza were Muslims. Ara made his money, or his living actually, as a car washer, and Khanna was a banker, despite the horrors that partition of the country had unleashed only some months previously. As Raza recalls, "What we had in common, besides our youth and lack of means, was that we hoped for a better understanding of art. We had a sense of searching, and we fought the material world. We had a sense, it was at our meetings and discussions that a great fraternal feeling, a certain warmth, and a lively discussion of ideas ensued. We criticized each other's work as surely as we eulogized about it. This was a period when there was no modern art in our country, and a period of artistic confusion." Now, to support the less privileged artists, Langhammer invited a group of Indian painters on Sunday mornings to his home on the Nepean Sea Road. Langhammer's, as I said, works are also there in the TIFR collection. We are told that among the topics keenly discussed were the various artistic movements in Europe, and that the painters were exposed to the color prints of works by Paul Klee, Vasily Kandinsky, Oskar Kokoschka, and Egon Schiele. They were entranced by French Impressionism and German Expressionism and the exciting possibilities both offered them. Soon the meetings took the form of a salon, with the artists congregating both at the Langhammer home and at the coffee house in the downtown Fort area. Later, the Bombay Arts Center Society Salon, which was renamed the Artists Aid Center, on the first floor of the Sassoon building on Rampart Rao, now K. Dubash Marg, was acquired by Emanuel Schlesinger. And this gave the PAG artists a venue to show their works. So you have Ara, Gaitonde, Bhendre, Samant, Hussain, Tayyab Mehta, all would be hanging around there for each other's company. What they would talk about was, you know, what were the kind of artists, and experiments that artists were engaging in India, where do you see international art heading, and what's going on regarding painting in different parts of the world. In 1948, Langhammer also organized an exhibition of modern French art, which consisted of copies of works of French artists, which offered the art community in Bombay yet another window into the art movements prevalent in Europe. But there were others who were patrons of art, as we've heard, Homi Bhabha, the most very influential, and Mulk Raj Anand, the writer who later became the influential editor of the magazine Marg. He just returned from London and held soirees at his home where the artistic community converged. Slowly, the PAG expanded its circle to include new members. So while Krishan Khanna was inducted by Hussain, Mohan Samant was voted in by Gare. Later, Gaitonde and Raiba were also invited to join the group by Hussain. And you see a number of their works also here in the TIFR collection. In the third PAG exhibition in 1952, held at the Bombay Art Society Salon, the number of artists was expanded to 11. And in addition to Gaitonde, you have K.H. Ara, you have Chapgar, you have Gare, you have Hazarnis, who Mott talked about, and we've seen that work today. You have Hussain, and you have Krishan Khanna, Raiba, Bhanu Rajopadhyay, who later became known as Bhanu Athaiya, Raza, and Souza. So by the time, of course, the exhibition was held, Souza and Raza had left for Europe to study contemporary art movements there and further their practice. Bakre soon followed suit, leaving Ara, Hussain, and Gare to carry on in Bombay. And I just want to end this, this period with a quote that came through, something that Krishan Khanna wrote in that show's catalog essay. He says, "Though each painter uses his own idiom, the styles of all are modern. We're not reckoning with eternity, nor do we concern ourselves with greatness. That, after all, would be to judge ourselves by standards that do not exist at present. We strive to interpret truth, each in our own way. And being painters first and foremost, the truth is necessarily aesthetic." Thank you.
Yes.
So that was in, just to give a bit of context, because, Sridhar had said, talk about that particular period. And since the topic of discussion today really is about, the moderns and their influence, on different generations, Prajakta, you, as well as you, Nalini. But I want to just sort of go back and then pose a question, which I know Nalini was posed to you also by Sridhar, but still I'd like to repeat it, which is, the TFIR has two of your oil on canvas works in their collection. The first is Death of an Individual, done in 1966. And the second is Egress One in 1970. And I just want to comment here, Death of an Individual, that's also in 66 was the year Homi Bhabha died in a very unfortunate plane crash. And I was just thinking about it when I was reading that. So tell us a bit about how the TIFR came to acquire both these works.
In 1966, I was 20 years old. I was still in the art school and a bit of a brat because nobody had art exhibitions when they were in school, the art school. But I wanted a kind of appraisal, a critique from my colleagues, my senior colleagues. At that time, I had a studio at Bhulabai, and my neighbors were people like Gaitonde, Tayyab, Hussain would come and go, Bal Chawda was there from time to time, Prafulla Dhanukar, Joshi at that time. So in order to show a massive amount of work for which I needed a critique, I had the show at Kali Pandol's, and it was very generous of him to accept this show. And the first people who came were Professor Menon, The registrar, Mr. Putran, and they were very fascinated by what I had done. Of course, it was a real thrill that finally they purchased a work, but it wasn't without debate, without conversation. And some of the things that we talked about at that time was color, because being a scientist, he wanted to know about, he knew of course about the color wheel and Newton and so on, but he said, what is the magic of color in art, in painting? So I said, well, what I've learned is that we know that blue recedes and yellow comes forward, but if you do the reverse in a certain setting in a painting, then you create magic. Oh. And that's what, for me, is the magic of painting. So he said, that's very interesting. Now, for that reason, I think that I find your work very interesting. The other thing he found, and we discussed this as well, he said, this angle that you've chosen is fascinating. It's a top angle view. And I said to him that, a cine club had started at that time, the Anandam Club. And we used to go en masse from the Bullabai to these films. And they were very well organized, in the sense, historically. So you saw the Nouvelle Vague, and you saw New Realism and things like this, and also Soviet cinema. And they were angles. So I said, in narrative art, it would be very interesting to use different lens positions. So the top angle view, the mid, the close up, the midpoint, and the long distance. And so I was talking about cinema at that time with him. So we had many conversations before they really came to the point where they said, well, this work we really should have, because it fits into the modernist idiom, and all the narratives that we've had together is what finally made this happen.
Right, and now that you say that, when I look at Death of an Individual, it is really the top angle
it's
shot,
the top
right?
Angle
I mean, you
shot.
Have a figure
yes.
in the center, and then
That's
you have
right.
these huddled yes. figures around it.
Right.
So, yeah, very much coming from, as
right.
you mentioned, cinema and that
yes.
particular perspective.
Yes.
And Egress, was that all bought later, or were they
yes,
both?
1970. That
yeah.
was another show I had, and again, that was after I finished at the art school. And it was, I had made a series of photograms at the Vision Exchange workshop that Akbar had started in 69. I didn't own a camera, but there was a dark room, and there was photosensitive paper and all the chemicals. So with all this, I started to make photography, but in a manner which was like a collage. With different opacities of paper, I could create a collage. And actually, Nasreen and I worked a lot on these things together. And Nasreen's work also changed in this collaboration. Her lines, etc., her curved spaces, and all of this came after that. But what's interesting is that when I had the show at Pandol, my plan was the photograms would be the same size as my paintings
oh.
and would have the same subject matter. Because at that time, photography was not at all accepted in art galleries. Nobody, of course, bought these things, and nobody bought them. So I wanted to show these works together with paintings about the same size. Now, what were the paintings about, as also the photograms? It was a kind of a fight I was having with Guy Tondé.
Oh.
Yes. We had many fights. Guy Tondé did very idealistic landscapes, beautiful sunsets, and all, you know, those, and they give a spiritual, and he used to tell me a lot about Zen Buddhism and Dr. Suzuki, etc. But when we stepped out of the Bullabai Memorial Institute, which was a beautiful building, opposite us was the sea. But it wasn't the Tata Garden that we have today. It was a junkyard. Everybody came and put all their rubbish there, old tires and even old cycles, and you know, it was a junkyard. I said, Guy, you know, do you see this? I see the sea, no doubt. But look what's obstructing us. It's a junkyard. He says, you're right. But I have to be idealistic. So anyway, so all my works, I was very influenced by his stratifications and the things. But I made junkyards, I made debris, I made a thing called Egress. And these are the works that
right.
Were shown along with my photograms. And the photograms were kind of a mirroring of the paintings. And so Egress was bought by the TIFR. And again, we had long discussions. You know, it was at Pandol, it was at Fort. So coming from the TIFR to Fort was not a big distance for, and they could take time off, you know, the scientists could come. And again, deep conversations over coffee and tea and things like this, which Kali Pandol very sweetly produced. So again, you know, this, what was the meaning of the striations? Why was I talking about these issues? I said they're social issues, so we really have to address these issues. And if artists don't address them, who will? And that's how slowly ideas of politics and sociology and anthropology come into my work from right. then on.
And it's a wonderful period, because I'm not sure whether we have these kind of conversations happening now, you know, I mean, in today's world, the way you've, you know, talking about color,
right.
talking about, you know, why certain themes.
But the Bullabai had a zeitgeist which was amazing. And if I today was asked to design an art school, I would do it on the basis of the Bullabai and the interdisciplinary arts. Because not only were we looking at the visual arts, that is painting and sculpture, but also dance, music, poetry, and theatre. I worked a lot in theatre with Satyadev Dubey
right.
in the Bullabai.
Yep.
So it was like, And the most amazing people were coming and going. You know, for an 18-year-old, I got the studio in 1964. I could see Al-Kazi performing on the lawn. The first installation of Hossein's work was on the lawn of the Bulawai. He put up a big tent, and he said to me, because I was there all the time, I mean, I was fishing and carrying glasses of water and tea and whatnot. He said, look, how I'm going to hang this Hossein. This I'm going to put here, because that red is very important to lure people in. And then I'm going to have a very somber work, a blue. And you cannot miss that, because after that I'm going to have yellow.
Right.
You see what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, this was the kind of amazing. And
you also, now that you're talking about the Bulawai, just sort of slight digress, but then, yeah, the works, Davier Wala in the TIFR collection, he was there at the Bulawai as well.
Yes.
Apilu was there as well.
Yes.
So,
yes.
You know, a number of the artists who in this collection, you know, were at the Bulawai
Desai. I knew them all. We were out. There used to be a cafe where we used to hang out just down the road from the Bulawai called Bombelli's. This is Bombelli. Where Amar Sins is today, unfortunately. But this was a great place. There was a prohibition, so you couldn't have a drink, but you could certainly have coffee. And you could buy this thing called Kona coffee. It was a bulb of coffee, transparent. And you could drink 3 or 4 hours, you'd sit together and drink this terrible coffee. And there was a Swiss pianist who would be playing ting-tong with this grand piano, totally out of tune. And then Altaf would join us, and then Bhupendra Karia, the photographer. So, you know, it became a real kind of cafe culture, exactly right. What they would do in Paris for that matter, you know.
Right, yeah. Right. Just coming back to, you've touched on it, but I just wanted to talk about the two works in the collection, and you know, would you like to talk about a bit about the palette, because you know, I really found this sense of loss, and both works have, you know, a very a somber palette, if I, you know, and so what was going on at that time?
Well, it was a young country, and there was much to be done. And I felt that whatever we had collected in the histories that had gone by, and we, the young generation, at that time I was the young generation, it was up to us then to start talking about what we were experiencing. Junkyard, debris, all of these things were actually there, but also there were metaphors. There were metaphors for the kind of class hierarchies, caste hierarchies, which later came into my work, and Sudhir actually talks about this, and that period we were really into it, the socio-political angles and so on, because then later there was the textile mill strike, etc. So all of this, we said that artists have to be the antenna of society, and somehow or the other we have to find images for this. How are we going to do this? And there comes in my admiration for the Mexican muralists. Mm. So our artists, the progressive, many of them left the country because there was a need to connect to the outside world, to in some sense get a kind of affirmation about what they were doing was valid in the international arena. But I think the later generation that comes in, that's my generation, we felt it was very important to be rooted in our culture and excavate from that culture an idiom which would be close to the people. It was very important for us to make a figure where a worker could walk in and say, right, this could be part of my family.
Right. Yeah. Prajakta, I want to just come to you. And, you know, you went to art college much later. You went in the 90s. And the works in the TIFR collection were put together from the 1950s to the 70s. So I want to ask you, which artists from the collection really resonate with you and why?
Thanks, Meera, and thanks, Sridhar. I entered JJ School of Arts in 1995. And it was a very interesting moment at that time. There were artists like Justin, Jitish, Bose was coming in and out, and Shilpa Gupta, who had some kind of a connection through Nalini. So I think there was a very vibrant moment in JJ where people were also almost all these artists were kind of reaching and creating a new language. The only memory I think I have of or the work that really affected me in a way was actually seeing from that generation or in between, because I think Nalini becomes the link between that generation to us, I think, and a strong important link. Because I remember seeing her show at the Kemold, which was these wall drawings. I think it was City of Desire, and it was amazing, because till then, of course, one is going through Western art history and is looking at various works from site-specific installations, which almost you feel like are kind of freeing you from this burden of just painting on a two-dimensional surface. And then you see something like a site-specific painting or a wall drawing in a gallery space like Kemold. It just opened up a lot of things at that time. Also, I think one was not looking at any of the progressives at that time, because it's impossible to kind of look back and think of creating a new new language. I think you come to college and you're thinking that, and you're going through the Western art and you're hoping that you become part of that history, and you know, you create, or is it possible for you to even create a new language? And in that age, you know, the young age that you are in, you're not kind of looking back at which artists, you know, you're, I mean, especially the progressives, I think. I mean, one was just looking at them as, you know, ancestors, which had kind of, okay. And also the color palettes, which had made painting look very serious and almost one-dimensional. I mean, that was what I was thinking then. So it was absolutely amazing to see this, this artist. I mean, it was amazing to see Nalini's work, and also one could understand that she was speaking of the and the politics in her work also kind of made you realize that it was not just the violence, the politics in the work. I think it also paved path for a lot of art thinking. I mean, it might not have infiltrated into the work directly, but I think the way she was painting these violent figures and was so much different from the aesthetical burden that I thought the others were carrying of making, just like Bendre's paintings, which one thought was moving towards a decorative direction, where I think at that moment one was keen on speaking of the immediate and the surrounding. And so I think Nalini for me would become like the link between them to us in a way.
When you speak like this, what comes to mind is a lacuna. And the lacuna has to do with the fact that we have no museum that you can go to and say, go and look at that Gaitonde. Yeah. We have no place in India where we can say, go and look at the Kalighat painting. I remember talking to students and explaining Kalighat, showing them reproductions, was just not the real thing. Yeah. That is our biggest lacuna, because a museum is a learning place that you can look at your ancient history. Yeah. Sure. You know, so you can go back to it. When you keep going back to, say, looking at a certain work which you've seen from time to time, it says something else to you, and because your mindset is different every time. You know, every time you look at something, it's telling you something else.
No, absolutely.
And that we have really missed. It's been like cutting off a limb out of your system. And this, I think, is something that it needs to be really addressed completely. Absolutely. We didn't even at that time, when I was a student, didn't have reproductions to look at. We had nothing. That's why I was lucky to be at the Bulab. I could see the process of the painting. I could see Gaitonde painting. I was really lucky. But what about the others? They had nothing like that.
No, but it becomes, I mean, absolutely. And I think it, so when you're in that moment of finding your own voice, I think you are just trying to kind of grab onto whatever you triggers you at that moment. But I think I look at it quite differently today. I mean, today one can look and see for what it is, and be at peace with it in a way.
And I think I'll come to that. Yeah, that's sure. One of my questions which I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
Nalini, coming back to the TIFR collection, I mean, you were barely 20 at that time when your work was, acquired. What did that mean for you as a young artist? I mean, to be part of this, you know, collection by this very important and influential collector or institution.
Well, you know what? First of all, I have to say something funny. It was 300 rupees, the work.
But it must have,
and for me, that was a princely sum.
That's what I was just going to say. It must have been a princely sum in those days.
I just had to share that because it's, you know, today it sounds so ridiculous. No, what did it mean to be in this collection? It was, how shall I say? It was like for whatever I had known about modernism and whatever I had read, and whatever I believed that this country should be looking to in the future, was modernism in the real sense. And my idea of modernism really came from our architects, Charles Currier. He would come once in a while to the Bhulabhai, but later almost every day to a vision exchange workshop. And he would talk about how young India would progress if we could provide housing, social housing, and how we would look to the very people who would make that progress possible, the workers. And the whole CIDCO project, New Bombay, I was, you know, if he came to the Vision Exchange workshop, I'd drop everything just to listen to his plans. And of course, now the books are out, and you can see what a vision the man had. And he tried to fulfill that in every way possible. It was an uphill task. So that modernism and what TIFR stood for, this was what really the fabric of that moment was in India, Air India being one.
Right.
Air India, TIFR, these were the two institutions that were public, they were collecting so that public could see the art that was being made at that time. The Air India collection was a bit different because they really had to showcase things which had an Indianness about it. So they probably have more B Prabhas than they would have here. So this collection is far more serious. And therefore, I did have a sense of pride that somebody like Professor Menon came and spoke to me for such long periods. It was really something. It meant a lot. You can imagine it never went away.
Right.
And it was even mentioned by the critics that they had come, he and Professor Putran, they would come from time to time. It meant a lot.
I can imagine.
Yes.
You've interacted a great deal with several of the artists who are in the TIFR collection, and I think we've spoken about this with Bhulabhai Desai Institute. Hussain was there, Gaitonde was there, Tayyab was there. Whose work did you gravitate to, and who do you think might have influenced you at the time?
Well, at that time, as I said, you know, the kind of quarrels Guy and I used to have certainly had an impact, positive and negative. Also, ways of seeing what JJ could not provide, because JJ was so academic. And we had to do the figure, and we had to really do a realistic figure. So it was like a whole other means of understanding what a picture can do, how you actually did create a sense of space, which a guy was extremely master at. And in the case of Tayyab, the angst and the existentialism in Tayyab's work, and the kind of, and I had access to both their libraries, which was really a very rich experience, you can imagine. I mean, from Tayyab I got Sartre and Simon. Mm-hmm. And from Tayyab I got Dr. Suzuki.
From Gaitonde, yeah.
From Gaitonde I got a lot on Zen Buddhism.
Right.
So it was like two different...
Yeah, yes. Two different worlds, yes. Almost.
And
yeah.
Then you had somebody, Souza I never really met, but Hussain I did. And the flamboyance of Hussain was something else. He was a performer. And when he walked into the Bhulabhai, everybody knew he'd come.
Right. I want to ask you, I think you've spoken a bit about this, about how Nalini was, you know, a major, you know, I mean, somebody that you look to. But I know, Prajakta, you also mentioned Nasreen, and I think there's one work in this collection. You know, how she also helped shape your sensibility and your language.
Yeah, sure. I think, Meera, I think around that time one was looking at most women artists. You know, you're keenly looking at the senior women artists and the kind of work that, you know, they were on to. So, of course, there were many others who are not part of the collection, from, say, Rumana Hussain to Anita to Arpita as well. Beautiful the way she would create these surfaces and figures kind of dissolving in these surfaces. But Nasreen was, I mean, so there's no specific thread, but I think with this most recent work that, I mean, which I've been doing, which is a more site-specific work where, which was shown recently at the Kunstmuseum Wolfsburg, and it was almost like 16-meter wall, where I, you know, used threads on the wall and I kind of made a crack on the wall. But I think mentally, for me, it's almost like you're thinking two-dimensionally in a way. So more like line drawings that kind of come onto the space. So that's, I think, some kind of a connection. But also, I think the women artists almost made you feel that you had to have or look at issues of body and you know, things that you had to kind of deal with. But at the same time, I think from where I come, I think I was quite sure that I wanted to speak about my immediate surroundings without it being autobiographical in a way. But so from the middle class family that one kind of came from in Thane, so the kind of architecture that one was living in to things that one had to deal on an everyday basis. So I think at that time one is kind of trying to look for, I think, almost fodder from all these, you know, earlier pioneers in a way. So yeah, but Nalini was amazing with students, and I think she would have so many things happening. I mean, I have faint memory of this, but I remember, like, I think even during the Sehmat thing, I think when there was something happening in Bombay, there was always this thing where she wanted to connect with the students, or even Vivan for that matter, would look for students, and that's where we would go, and you know, you see a different part of Indian art history that was being formed than the one that was, because for us it was, the access was quite limited. I mean, one could just see it in, through reproductions and yeah.
So, right. Yeah, you didn't have the chance to.
No.
At the JJ, were they works of these, of some of these artists?
Some of
the
them,
JJ?
Yes, some of them, and they were kind of locked up for the longest time, and I think only towards my fourth year, I think, which must have been, I think, around 97, I think they tried to, 97, 98, they tried to get it out. So I remember seeing a Langhammer at that time physically and feeling quite amazed with the quality at which the figures were done. And but also, I think, within my own practice, I think there's also this thing of the still life. I'm fascinated with the way still lives are painted and throughout history in that sense, and how one looks at an object. And the more, I think it's almost beautiful when you're trying to capture something that's in front of you. I think it almost adds in layers of memory and time within the painting when you're looking at something and painting instead of a photograph. So I think that was also something that I was trying to find for myself when my contemporaries, I think, were looking at the photographic image in that sense. So, yeah.
But what I find in your work is that the whole process and the process of the very thing that you have photographed, that is also getting transformed. In, you know, that it's going to change, that there's a whole future to what you're looking at, which I find absolutely amazing. And to connect that to Nasreen
in Nasreen's work, especially the later works, you know that you're going beyond. Yeah. There's something over that. Mm. There's something over the lines that she's drawn. And then when the later lines were more obelisks and things, yeah, like this, the discs and so on, there's always something beyond, you know. Therefore, also in your work, there's something beyond, which never stays as it is. There's always a future to it.
It transcends.
Yes, the transcendence, exactly. Yeah, yeah. And there's, in that sense, there's a spirituality, yeah, in both.
Yeah. Ashvidhar, how are we doing for time? Yeah, okay, sure. So I think maybe one question. I think one thing that has struck us, and especially Sridhar, since you asked for an all-women panel, was that there are very few women in the collection. I think you have Prabha, you have Pilu, and Nasreen as well. I mean, Nasreen, one work, and what do you think the reasons for that were? Asking you, Nalini first, and then Prajakta to comment on that.
Well, it's different in Prajakta's time. But in my time, there was a very patronizing attitude to women artists. The one woman artist who was in the progressive group, Bano, completely changed tack. She went into costume design and she did very well. But I think there must have been some kind of animosity, even towards Nasreen, because she was really on the periphery. And I used to say, she used to love the artist, she used to love Bal, and she used to be very friendly with Hussain. In fact, when Hussain was making his film in Rajasthan, she went with him and she photographed him shooting. But they put her very much on the periphery. She was like a mascot. But that's because the times were like that. There was a kind of a misogynist attitude to women. Let's face it, it was there. And when I had my first show at Pandole's in 1966, there was a very senior artist who still lives, who came and said, "Beta, ye sab to theek hai, par shaadi kar lo."
I heard that too. So weird.
It's weird.
Okay, so on that note, I think Sridhar, thank you very much, both Nalini
thank
and
you
for sharing
very,
your
very lively
sharing your views on this, and thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot, Sridhar. It's been a wonderful evening.
So, first of all, let me thank the panel very much, Nalini, Meera, and Prajakta, for this very enlightening discussion. It's actually being videoed and we'll share it. And, you know, I think when we do these efforts, we should not get totally dismayed these days by the, you know, actual lack of physical participation, because there are so many other ways to disseminate these. And this will also become part of our archival footage. And I think this is going to be the first in another long line of events that we plan to do, and you know, so thanks again for flagging this off. And very quickly thank all of you taking time and coming here and being part of this event. Thanks to the TIFR administration, especially Sandeep, for making this possible. Thanks, Minnie, very much for, you know, helping us. Actually, I must confess that it was Minnie's enthusiasm which actually made all this happen. I mean, we could have easily given up at some stage, but she was very, very enthusiastic, and she was more excited about this art collection than anyone else. So thank you so much for this. And Vidita for actually being, you know, the spearhead and getting this film done. And I would also like to thank Mott. He had to leave early today, but Mortimer Chatterjee has been very generous with his time, and he has given us a lot. And in fact, I would say that the book that he put together has helped us make sense of this collection, because at some point things were just getting out of hand. Nobody knew where what was, and this has really helped consolidate. And you know, we now have actually a good record of the collection. So thank you again. I may have, of course, missed out on thanking someone or the other, but okay, I will apologize to them right away. And yeah, of course, it was my brilliance that actually made this all happen. Thank you.
Thank you.